It's my pleasure to get to introduce our sort of keynotes, like a way too straight word for what we're doing, but our speakers who are here in the afternoon to help us work through some of the themes that we've already raised. So Katherine Sender is professor of media and sexuality and communication studies at the University of Michigan. Yeah, she specializes in gender, sexuality, and gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, and queer representation. Her research areas span television, audiences, creative industries, and cultural production, marketing and consumer culture, and globalization. Her current research focuses on sex museums as sites to investigate transnational sexual mobilities. I'm so excited Katherine's here. She has this knack for work that's surprising and tackles topics that are publicly immediate, but somehow still usually unexamined until she gets there. I admire her for her work, for being a queer theorist who helps us learn more about ourselves and our media, and I'm so excited for her to be our interlocutor with Shaka McGlotten, who is Associate Professor of Media, Society, and Arts at Purchase College, State University of New York, and Doris and Carl Kempner Distinguished Professor, 2016 to 2018. Their recent chapter, Black Data in No Tea, No Shade, is just out, which follows, which follows virtual intimacies, media affect, and queer sociality, and black genders and sexualities, which is co-edited with Dana Ayn Davis. Like Katherine, I've been reading Shaka's work for a long time, and I'll admit that I was almost kind of nervous to invite them both to participate, and I was so thrilled when the answer was yes, and I'm so thrilled that they're here now, so I'm going to turn it over.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Is this working, and can people hear me okay? Okay, great. Just for me, just to open this out, I just wanted to say what an incredible delight and pleasure it is to be here. It's an amazing day. I'm just so thrilled to see all of these great people. The panels so far have been really wonderful, and I've already learned a lot, and it's a real privilege to have this conversation with you. And, you know, we've been engaging with each other's work and sort of working out some ideas and really looking forward to chatting. So do you want to say, and thank you for the invitation. That was the other thing.
Yeah, that was one of those easy invitations to accept. It's just like, yes, thank you. I don't know how long it took me to respond. Sometimes it takes me a long time, but that wasn't one of them. And yeah, I just wanted to thank the organizers and the sponsors and everyone who's here. It really is great to see so many people working in this area. You know, I think I've been doing internet-based research since 1999, and when I tell some of my students that, they're like, oh. So I've been around the block a few times, and I'm still just learning, really learning so much from all of you.
Great, so how I thought this would go is, just in terms of like reviewing some of Shaka's work in the last few days, there are some very compelling photos across your different projects. So I thought we could frame the initial part of the discussion around four photos, and then we'll open it out to a period of discussion. We've got a nice long session, I think it's an hour and a half, so we'll have time to sort of go back and forth. So the place that I want to start is with your book, Virtual Intimacies, and right in the concluding chapter, is this image, not into spice or rice. And for those of you who haven't read the book, the conclusion is about kind of failed intimacies in some kinds of ways. So I thought this was a sort of a good way to open up a conversation to really talk about what do we mean, or when you talk about virtual intimacies, you do a really beautiful job of sort of elaborating this. And so I was wondering whether you would maybe start there. What are virtual intimacies? What does virtuality bring to intimacy? And also your idea of imminence, which I think is very exciting.
Yeah, so I started the virtual intimacies project came out of my dissertation research, which was largely about public sex in Austin, but a significant portion of that research had to do with the ways that Austin, as a city that was being groomed to become a kind of new Silicon Valley in the late 90s and early 2000s, was an early adopter of all of these new technologies, everything from chat rooms and so on. So it was a very technologically sophisticated city. And so I was interested in the ways that these earlier geographies, these earlier kinds of materialities around public sex were increasingly being, initially I thought supplanted, but really just overlaid with these other kinds of digital, again, we can use like a word like affordances. And so there was actually a kind of multiplication effect in terms of the kinds of sexual practices and connections that people were able to engage in. And you know, one of the things that sort of animated that research and then I tried to weave throughout the book was the relationship of queer sociality and queer intimacies to failure. So failure, of course, is you know, in the context of queer intimacies, might be the ways in which queer intimacies are kind of seen as always already failed, right? Because of the ways they don't adhere to heteronormative logics, whether of coupledom or of family, or you know, you guys know the drill. And at the same time, there is a kind of imminence, like a kind of latent potentiality in intimacy all the time. So first, there's all the ways that queers resisted this failure, this sense of failure, and created all kinds of new counterpublics, new forms of sociality, new forms of kinship, and so on. But I was still really struck by this sense of failure. So it might have, so in my ethnographic research on public sex, it showed up, for example, in the ways people mourned all kinds of losses that were tied to HIV/AIDS, right? So there was this kind of failure for the politics of sexual liberation that was sort of happening in the 70s to ever sort of fully realize itself. So in addition to the kind of heteronormative gaze that saw these intimacies as always already failed, you also had the kind of very material sorts of failure of certain things to be realized. But within failure, there's always some excess or some potentiality. Failures are never absolute. So I was just interested in that kind of tension. And I guess the other side of the failure then would be imminence, this idea that there is always something, there is always a kind of potentiality there that has not either been captured or expressed. And you know, so in this work I was, of course, influenced by people like Jack Halberstam, who wrote a book called The Queer Art of Failure. And my work with imminence was really, you know, coming from Deleuze. This sense too of, especially when we think about our scholarship as queer scholars, or and especially queer scholars of technology or of the internet, that there is always something latent that we actually don't know yet. And that for me was something important to continuously point to. So there was a sort of balancing act between the failures of queer intimacies from the outside, from the inside, and the ongoing imminence, the ongoing potentiality of queer sociality.
Mm-hmm. Great. So you talk a little bit about sexual publics and sex publics in the book. So I was just really trying to think through what does it mean? What do you mean by sex publics, and how? What are virtual sex publics, and you know, are there meaningful distinctions around that kind of virtuality and/or different, you know, different kind of mediated versions of sex publics?
Yeah. So I'll start by answering the unanswered question from the first one, which is how do I understand the virtual? So that's from most of my understanding, it comes from Deleuze, and where immanence and the virtual are kind of understood in the same way. So the virtual is real but not concrete, ideal but not abstract. This is some parsings of that. In terms of the sex publics, maybe the easiest way to address that question has to do with all of the ways in which, especially for gay men, but not only, sex was key, like a really part of the glue of these queer networks, these queer social networks. So when I use the term sex publics, I'm both referring to these kinds of hailed groups of people who are engaged in some kinds of mutually, like, engaged in sex together, and I'm also referencing, in a way, public sex. All sex, in some ways, often, or many ways, sex can be made public. And here, of course, the work of Lauren Berlant, Michael Warner, was really important. These aren't ideas that I came up with on my own. when it came to virtuality and sort of virtual sex publics, again, I think in many key ways they overlap, even today. But you do see, and this is, I think, again, going back to this notion of eminence, there is all kinds of things that are constantly happening all the time. Just thinking about certain terms that have emerged in recent years, say through dating or hookup apps, like ghosting, right? This idea that you're talking to someone, you're like into each other, you share some pictures, and then they disappear, right? So there are all kinds of new sexual practices that are emergent kind of constantly. Or if you guys, you know, how many of you think of your phones as an erotic object now, right? Like, what's foreplay? Foreplay is swiping, right? Foreplay is tapping. Foreplay is clicking, right? So when I think about that again, I'm not using the notion of the virtual as developed by Deleuze in a faithful way. I'm actually kind of trying to have it both ways, the virtual as both eminence and as something, you know, quite concrete. But those are some of the ways that I think about it. So, and I still think that even now, oh my God, like 18 years after I started, is that right?
Yeah. That is correct math.
You can call her daddy. So, you know, even 18 years later, I think that these worlds are still overlaid in the sense that even public sexual encounters, right, the sort of the classic, you know, kind of cruising encounters, are mediated by through virtual means, right? Through digital means. So people will arrange now to, you know, meet at a particular university bathroom or a park or whatever using, you know, Grindr, Scruff, Snapchat, whatever.
Right? Yeah, great. So I was really interested in your discussion of black affect mm-hmm. as being, you talk about anxiety, paranoia, including looking at John Jackson's work from Pan, and also optimism. And I was wondering whether you felt you could sort of extrapolate on virtual intimacies is a form of cruel optimism, in Balint's productive phrase.
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, absolutely.
I wanted you to go there in the book, and you didn't quite.
No, I don't know why. Yeah, I can't remember. Like, that book was very influential for me, and I read it, you know, like, this is embarrassing to admit, but I probably read 3 academic monographs cover to cover in a year. I don't know, is that bad? Is that good? I mean, is it good? I don't know. And that was one of the ones that I read, and it was one of those books too, for those of you who've read it or who haven't read it, it gets really under your skin, mm-hmm. and then everything becomes cruel optimism. It may have been that I read it, and I may have read an article, and it's there, but not entirely. But no, I think virtual intimacies, I think that would be a great way of framing it, and also sort of highlighting that paradox between, you know, going online with potentially this sense of openness, right? The eminence of this virtual space, but then that longing to connect may not actually be nourishing for us in the ways that we actually are able to connect or not with other people. What's her exact phrasing?
Juxtapositional?
No, I'm thinking of the cruel optimism. She has a very particular phrasing of it that is quite concise and lovely. It's when you know, the to continue to long after the things that do us harm, right? You know, when I was thinking about black affects too, you know, I was a student of Katie Stewart, and you know, so have been, you know, in the orbit of a lot of the people who were doing affect theory and affect studies, especially from a kind of cultural studies or anthropological perspective, though actually Katie Stewart still remains one of the only anthropologists who've really kind of tackled it directly. And I was just sort of struck by the absence of not discussions of race, but sort of the racial specificity. So lately I've been working more within, I've always sort of been within this feminist science and technology studies lineage, And I thought about affect theory, and I noticed it was just like you have this body of theory that never really intersected with critical race theory, except, you know, Lauren does it in some ways, other people do it in a few ways, but it was as if it sort of took on this its own power. And very few scholars, this is not true anymore, but at the time, very few scholars of color had really had been really talking about it, and very few scholars of affect were talking about it. And in the Black Data work that I'm doing now, you know, I'm sort of, you know, the subtitle of that book is tentatively Queer of Color Critique Meets Network Culture Studies. So, and one of the things I've been thinking a lot about is how there was another critical theoretical concept, Afrofuturism, which never kind of achieved the visibility or the theoretical weight of affect, right? Which affect took over, you know, even by the early 2000s, it was all over the place. But Afrofuturism, there were these, you could kind of do like a little chart of it. There was like a little rise and a dip. It would disappear, mm-hmm. and then it would be a rise, and someone publish a book and talk about it, and then it would be a dip. And I'm really just interested in how, thinking about Black affect and thinking about in these digital contexts, more and more I'm gonna be moving toward extending that into a longer discussion of mm-hmm. Afrofuturism and trying to draw out some of these theoretical and historical connections.
Yeah, I mean, I just to sort of follow on from that, I mean, you know, one of the things that I think is really helpful about Balint's expression is the ways in which these affects get kind of folded into forms of revenue generation, monetization, capitalization of different kinds. Maybe you could talk a little bit more about how you see these virtual intimacies being capitalized in different ways and how those ways are changing, because mm-hmm. it seems to me that even since your book came out, there are other options.
I think from like the very beginning of my research, when I was really looking at the chat rooms at gay.com, there was never a time outside of neoliberal capitalism. Mm-hmm. Though my feeling was that when I was first encountering these really were vibrant spaces of sociality. And then you began to have different kinds of emphases. For example, when I was first in these chat rooms, it was really text-based still. And so there was a lot of writing. You know, you would build up sexual tension through text, and then maybe you would cam. And after a year or two, as cameras became more widely available, there was a demand to have a photo. Mm-hmm. No one would talk with you if you didn't have a photo. Mm-hmm. That is sort of a maybe an intensification or an acceleration of that neoliberal logic. Mm-hmm. And certainly all of the apps, you know, I think Grindr was released in 2009, they really are, like, you could just, I mean, a case study in neoliberal capitalism. Right, in the ways that people are turned into little grid, you know, or like the design of these apps, whether it's the grid of Grindr or Scruff or the swiping of Tinder, right? There is in the former examples, there's just this flattening, like you're like one of the different cereal boxes. And the question is like, how can you stand out? You know, are you gonna be Fruity Pebbles? Are you gonna be Lucky Charms? Are you gonna be, you know, are you gonna be like some muesli? And then like what's gonna get you, and it is part of this whole, you know, logic of self-branding, like self-advertising. Or in these other apps, and this also includes the dating apps that you would use on a desktop, you're more likely to use on a desktop, there's a kind of gamification at work, mm-hmm. right? So when you swipe through a deck, you swipe through decks in Tinder, and if you connect with someone, you know, the app will ask, you want to write to them or do you want to keep playing, mm-hmm. right? So intimacy has been turned into a kind of game, and arguably, you know, even in the 70s, you have like psychologists writing books like The Games People Play, right? So mm-hmm. it's not that intimacy hasn't had a history of being related to playing a mm-hmm. game, but I think it has achieved a certain kind of, like, I don't even know if we're actually at the mm-hmm. apex, like it might still be going somewhere else, but, you know, yeah, I'll stop there.
I also just wanted to come back to your idea of browsing, which mm-hmm. before we actually, you know, talk particularly about this image, but it's in the same chapter. Mm-hmm. And I love your discussion of browsing as a form of sort of failed connection that is nonetheless full of its own kinds of intimacies, mm-hmm. and possibilities and imminence. It made me think about the gendered dimensions of hookup apps particularly. Adrian Shaw and I published a special issue of a journal on queer technologies earlier last year. And one of the pieces in it is by Sarah Murray and Megan Sapner-Ankerson, and they talk about how sort of efforts to make a lesbian app were really hard because the and because of very different kinds of temporalities, right? Mm-hmm. So the sort of capital generating logic of Grindr and Scruff and Tinder is about speed. You know, it's about speed and rapidity and lots of options and, you know, selecting and then kind of moving into a different phase, and that's how they make money. And various attempts to produce apps for lesbians have been really fraught, and partly around their temporal features, because the kind of conventions of lesbian sociality and kind of romantic relationality have been much slower. And so, you know, much more tentative, you know, you want to chat, and then you want to chat some more, and then you want to think about it for a week, and, you know, or whatever the sort of stereotype is. Which, of course, drives the venture capitalists nuts, because it's like, we can't have, like, these two members going off and chatting for a month before they decide whether or not they're going to, you know, get a cup of tea. And so maybe you could talk a little bit about, you know, I mean, you talk a lot about the queer potentials of virtual intimacies, but where you think the sort of places of friction are around the gendered dimensions, mm-hmm. of that.
So, you know, when this was the book that I wrote in a way for tenure, and I would write a different book now. And when I go back and sometimes I read it, and I'm like, I don't even know who wrote it. Not because the idea, it's like sometimes I'm like, who wrote this? It's like great. But then other times it's just, when you do this, it's like, so you forget. Like I had to look at some of what I had written just to remind myself of, like, oh yeah, like those are facts that I knew once, mm-hmm. and I've written. But when I did do that research, even though the book is mainly focused on the experiences of gay men, I did conduct interviews with women, trans folk, and others. They, you know, for all kinds of reasons, they didn't appear in this book. One thing I think is that with the gendered dimensions, so there have been efforts to create apps like, for example, like Bumble, right, which were more straight focused, but the idea there was that a man couldn't connect to a woman unless the woman had already signaled her interest in the guy, right? So there was a kind of gatekeeping effect. With the, and there have also been other efforts to create apps and to market them explicitly as not hookup apps, because there is this kind of trajectory of these apps where they are meant for sociality, but almost instantly are appropriated for sexual, mm-hmm. purposes. In terms of thinking about lesbian relationality and temporality, I'm not actually, I mean, maybe the lesbians I know are just really fast, but I'm not sure that all of those distinctions actually hold. I do think that gay male sort of intimate sociality, sexual socialities, stranger socialities are really fast, but I'm not sure, you know, I wonder if the problem really is around temporality, mm-hmm. you know.
What might it be around if it wasn't around temporality?
I think maybe the forms of intimacy, mm-hmm. so the forms of proximate, like, mm-hmm. this is just a wager, but like the forms of proximate intimacy. So my guess would be that, you know, folks, you know, AFAB folks are interested in certain forms of interaction that are durational, mm-hmm. right? It doesn't mean you don't hook up, right? But it's like there's a kind of durational, you know, thing there that has to do with a certain kind of desire for proximity. Mm-hmm. So maybe this is the extended, I mean, this is the sort of extension, the more extended temporality. You know, but I can't help but think of the, you know, the classic, you know, what do lesbians do on a second date? Mm-hmm. You know, like rent a U-Haul. because there is a speed to lesbian, there is a accelerated temporality to lesbian sociality as well, but it, you know, the gay male would be like, thanks for coming over, like 20 minutes, you know, it's like, hi, we're social, and like, bye-bye, yeah. 20 minutes mm-hmm. later. Whereas the lesbian temporality, I think for all kinds of reasons, mm-hmm. are stretched. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that, it'd be interesting to, maybe someone here can do research with programmers and developers who are trying to work on those apps to understand whether the problems they're facing are problems that have to do with their own assumptions mm-hmm. about lesbian sociality or something else, you know? I do think, too, that, you know, women, not just lesbian-identified women, but when you think about the socialities that really made the web social, my sense is a lot of those were driven by people who were assigned female at birth, mm-hmm. like forums, fan pages, mm-hmm. fan fiction, yeah. and so on. Like, gay men didn't, they engaged in a much, like the bandwidth of gay male sociality was actually much more narrow.
Much more focused, right?
Yeah. I don't know, does that answer?
I think that's very interesting.
I saw this volume, I read the introduction to it recently, but I want to read that article.
So let's talk about this image, because you have it, you talk about different forms of sort of failed intimacy. And so this, why don't you talk about where this came from and what this, you know, whether, what kinds of failure and what kinds of productivity come out of this site, which is called Douchebags of Grindr,
yeah.
right? The reasons that may or may not be obvious.
So this image comes from a website called Douchebags of Grindr. It was basically a name and shame website. It's as far as I know, no longer posting new content. But essentially, it was calling people to account for their fat phobia, femme phobia, racism, and so on. And it was just sort of highlighting what had been, by the time the website went up, like already a well-established pattern of, you know, racist, effeminophobic, and, you know, fat phobic, transphobic discourse in these apps. I got to it sort of, again, through being interested in browsing. In other words, that this idea that, in spite of, in some ways, what I just said, that not everyone is going online to get off. There is a kind of, there is a logic imminent to browsing itself, right? That can be the aim, is just going through. And one of the things people would do, you know, and it's even, I think, more heightened now with the sort of phenomenon of catfishing or baiting, the B-A-I-T-I-N-G, not the other baiting. With baiting is they're just looking to collect stuff. They're looking to collect pictures. They're looking to collect weird stories. They're looking to collect douchebags. And so, yeah. So that was the site. And I think that there's an interesting ethics to the site in that it wasn't a widely. It was like it got a little bit of press. You know, it was operative, I think, for a couple of years, but they. It wasn't something you would just stumble on, right? So you kind of had to find it. So, you know, here I did a really quick job because I had the original file, but in the book, you know, it's pixelated a little bit nicer. But it did kind of present the dilemma that people were talking, me with the dilemma people were talking about navigating earlier, which is namely, like, how do you deal with something that is sort of semi-publicly available? Like, so here someone did a screenshot and then posted on a website of this person. And in the book, what I use, and the person actually has sunglasses on, so I was like, do I need to blur the person's identity even more? And in the end, I opted to do it, and even in a really shitty way for this present, you know, for this image. Like, I was like, you know, Katherine was like, can you send me an image? And I was like, block, block, go. Maybe this has to do, again, with the sort of narrow bandwidths, or some of the narrow, like, the these forms of gay male sociality that have a kind of narrow bandwidth that are built, where there are all of these sort of exclusionary hierarchies built into gay male sociality. And when I was first sort of engaging the work with public sex and doing field work on public sex, there was a sense that, as Sam Delaney wrote about in Times Square Red, Times Square Blue, that certain kinds of public sex spaces were more egalitarian than these new online spaces, in the sense that people were much more likely to simply say something racist, and that there was more cross-race and cross-class interaction in these earlier kind of moments of queer sociality. Now, you know, Leo Bressani is really clear on this point, and I agree with him, which is that even in the bathhouse, that gay male sexual practices are like mercilessly, and bodies and everything else are kind of mercilessly ranked. But there was still like a much greater potential for interaction. So in an app like Grindr, any searchable app, you can decide what you're looking for, right? You can actually exclude people from even showing up for you. So you think you're into, you know, ginger twinks. You can only search for ginger twinks if you want to, but if you go to the bathhouse or the public toilet, you can't choose who goes there. And there are certain possibilities imminent to that real world space that that these online spaces can simply preclude or exclude. Right. So like this dude, even though he's Mateo, I don't know, whatever. He might not be into spice or rice, aka Latinos or Asians, but if he'd gone to that club and taken some ecstasy and gone to the back room, maybe he would have been into both, you know, or they would have been into him.
Yeah, great. So what I want to do now is move on to some of your more recent work. I was very happy to hear this come up in the panel this morning. This is actually an image that you, or two images that you sent me by Zach Glass, who's doing this this really interesting artwork, looking at kind of messing with facial recognition data, and that the ways in which these are becoming increasingly fine-tuned to sort of, in quotes, recognize certain types of people with for me, very clearly worrying outcomes. So you talk in this paper about this idea of black data, which I think is really interesting. So if you could begin by talking about what you mean by black data, and both in, well, actually, let's start there.
Sure, so I started thinking about this maybe 4 years ago, and the thinking really began around what's now called algorithmic discrimination. So the ways that these seemingly objective or neutral efforts to code something actually within the codes themselves, the codes themselves can demonstrate these hierarchies, right? These hierarchies are reproduced, racial hierarchies, certain kinds of assumptions are reproduced because people are doing the programming. You know, it's not some, abstract, totally neutral AI or something. So with black data, I was thinking about that's sort of where it began. And then I sort of thought, well, okay, so this is interesting because actually black people have historically, especially in the US, been data, right? They've been operationalized as data, whether as revenue stream, like as commodities, and therefore as revenue streams, during the transatlantic slave trade, as commodities that needed things like to be insured against loss or theft, in the 20th century, the ways that black people are reduced to data as in terms of statistical deviations or even statistics related to HIV/AIDS infection, right? So black people are kind of abstracted away from their embodiment and their ordinary humanity into data for other people to consume. I was also thinking a lot in 2013, so I started thinking about this in early 2013, and then the Snowden revelations came about. And so then I was really thinking also about mass surveillance, big data, and sort of biometric technologies as the kinds of things Zach is working on. So then black data was not just these sort of histories of datification of Black people, but also you know, evoked things like Black sites, right? Black blocks, the Black box, you know? So there were these other sort of series of associations that I started to make. And you know, right now the project is still, I've written a couple of chapters, including the one that just came out in No Tea, No Shade, and another one that hopefully will come out in this journal, Dark Matter, that's sort of been lingering for a few years. And then I hope also to do some field work at a people of color makerspace in Oakland called Liberating Ourselves Locally. So there will be an ethnographic component. A lot of it does focus, the idea will be focused on the work of artists. So I should say too that so Black data isn't just a sort of negative critique. It's also thinking about the ways that Black people have created and engaged technological technology and used expressive culture to not just challenge their datification, but using technology to express something about Black life and culture. So, you know, I've been looking a lot at, you know, some of my archive is like trans women of color on YouTube, right? Who are, you know, making these kind of micro publics, like T.S. Madison, other people who are making these kind of micro publics available through technology. Elizabeth Chin, an anthropologist, did this amazing project called the Laboratory of Speculative Ethnology, where she you know, drew extensively on Afrofuturist idioms to create these amazing like bodysuits and performances in public spaces. And so I think, you know, as I've been working more on the project, you know, from the beginning there was this sort of sense that I would be spending a lot of time thinking about expressive culture, about art, contemporary art. But there is more and more a sense that I'm going to be returning to Afrofuturism as a conceptual framework and try to, I don't want to use the word, it's never gone away, but like just bring it forward, you know, to bring it forward in a way that it never seemed to have been brought forward. And there is actually, I shouldn't say I'm not alone in this. So as I started doing this work in 2013, there has been a proliferation of amazing work from African-American studies, Black queer studies, and many people are actually re-engaging these questions of technology in very compelling ways. So even people like Kara Keeling, there was a number of people at the Affect Theory Conference, if you guys go online, that was held in Pennsylvania a couple years ago. There was a whole stream of work on race, and many of those people are working with both theories of affect and theories and dealing with technology in interesting ways. Mm-hmm. So I'd really recommend that people, you know, check that out.
Great. I mean, when I was reading this chapter, I couldn't help thinking, remembering, and is Sharona still here? Oh, so this would be a perfect one for her. So these are images from Frances Galton, who back in the late 19th century was doing these similar kinds of activities of sort of compositing data and trying to find a link between a kind of normative facial image and that says something particular about the body and about the person and about the self. So I just, you know, I thought this is actually a really long project of really trying to work with compiled data across lots of different subjects, mm-hmm. obviously big data with many more, to try and think about, you know, what is the face of the pervert or the queer mm-hmm. or the syphilitic or, you know, whatever the, right. The person is supposed to be. But also I wanted to ask you about what you think about going back to this idea of publics. I mean, sort of my first book was about gay marketing and how marketers took all of these sort of aggregated sort of consumer data, really inaccurately collected, right. and sort of said, this is the gay consumer. And it was collected through, mostly through gay publications, which of course had very limited readership and the numbers of people who would sort of volunteer that information was very specific, the kinds of people who felt safe enough to do that. And so, I'm really interested to hear what you would say about, like, what does it mean? So we've moved from, like, gay print publications through kind of the portal phase, you know, mm-hmm. gay.com, Planet Out, those kinds of yeah. things, to much more disaggregated contexts, but very differently aggregated materials. So it's moving from the print medium through the portal to the algorithm as a form of organizing. And so how do we have to think differently about publics and or markets, you know, when forms of collecting and passing data have changed so much?
I'd actually be interested in hearing more what you think about that. I like that way that from print to the portal to the algorithm. I'd have to think about that.
Yeah.
I mean, well, first of all, I think it's now easy, much easier for marketers or, you know, companies to simply do certain forms of data scraping where they wouldn't have to use such a small sample size, like in the era of, you know, print, when people are gathering data to like think about how do you market to gays based on this very, as you said, very limited sample size. And I think back to the portals like Planet Out or gay.com, and these were not, I think about them like, when I look back on them, I don't think of them as searchable, or certainly not easily searchable. But then I think about like Tumblr. That's really searchable, like really easy because of, you know, the logic of the tag. But I'm not really sure. I mean, is there a gay market right now outside?
Well, what does that look like? I mean, I think people are still targeted in ways. I mean, you know, that there was ages ago, there was that article, you know, Facebook knows you're gay even if your mother doesn't. And, you know, the ways, very clever ways in which algorithms, you know, look at the media you like, the friends you have.
I see.
And so, you know, even if you haven't, you know,
I get underwear ads on my Twitter feed or when I had Facebook, like early in the morning. They figured out that I'm going to buy underwear, and I'm most vulnerable to buying it when I'm not fully awake.
Or dressed.
Or dressed, exactly. They're going to be like, you're probably going to think about this while you're sitting on the toilet.
Right.
So, you know, so yeah, there is this kind of, the kind of, the predictive capacities of algorithms, you know, I think are very important in thinking through this. Like, does the gay, what does the gay market look like now? But I also think about certain, again, to go back to the concept of failure, I think of apps like Grindr as failed. And it wasn't for lack of users. It wasn't for lack of venture capital. It wasn't for anything. They just couldn't, you know, I think they've moved through a couple of iterations. I can't remember if they, does anyone know, were they sold? Did they sell? Did the owner sell Grindr? Did.
Sale.
It was a majority sale, right? I haven't followed it since that closely. But so there's actually like some kind of problem with it, right?
In terms of monetizing?
Yeah, I mean, when Grindr first came out, it was free to use, and then they kind of created these tiered systems, which is, I think, a very very typical way. But what would happen is that, you know, at least in these kind of gay, largely, the Grindr is no longer entirely gay male, the I guess I'd call it the ecology of the app changed. So, or like, just like with the chat rooms at gay.com, like, when you first went there, it was like this great, vibrant sense of sociality. You could get dick to your house faster than a pizza. But over time, the, certain kinds of conventions, maybe familiarity with other people who are in the network, the environment changed. And I think this, the same is true of a lot of these apps. So, a lot of people, like a lot of younger gay men, won't use Grindr, or they migrate to other apps, or they use, you know, Craigslist. Or so I think that there's a challenge in like holding on to a market and really being able to accurately anticipate the market. And I think part of that might be to do with the ways that with many of these apps, people, even if the app developers understand something about how those apps will be used, they can't actually anticipate the uses to which they will be put. So then you have the developers responding over time to how people are actually using an app. So like Snapchat today is very different than Snapchat 4 years ago, right? But I think that I said enough about that. I'd actually be really interested in hearing more from you about this.
I don't know. I mean, I feel like there's something about a porousness of a boundary that algorithmic forms of organization enable, for good and bad. And I also sort of am sort of really struck by this kind of relationship with the kind of the physical market, like gay bars, gay bookshops, you know, lesbian, you know, stores and so on, and how that part of this sort of multiple intersectionalities with other forms of social relationality have made different, and I don't quite know how to describe that difference, this idea of, you know, I'm in the gay market, this is where I go, you know, if I'm in an urban setting, for instance, this is where I go to drink, and this is where I go to shop, and, you know, these are my gay friends, or lesbian friends, or queer friends. My question was more just, I want to know what you know about, what you think about this, because I don't feel like I've sort of got my head around, what would it mean, and this is actually a sort of research question for me, what would it mean to study the gay market now, and how would I go about that? But I'd actually really like to move, because I'm just getting aware of time. You talk about, in light of these sort of very kind of sort of invasive data collecting and organizing strategies that are happening across the board, but differently inflected for different groups. You talk about, this idea of black ops, you know, mm-hmm. the idea of sort of going undercover, secrecy, masking, hence the Zach Glass masks, and how, you know, that these might be strategies of resistance. And it begged for me the question of who can't afford to go to be secret, to be hidden, to be, unseen. And for example, I was thinking about, again, going back to Samuel Delaney's wonderful book, you know, you are much safer on a very busy street in New York at 4 a.m. than you are, you know, somewhere where there aren't other people around. And so being seen for some people might be strategies of survival. Or being covered, being unseen, might make you more available to harassment and threat. So I just wanted to sort of turn that on its head a little bit and say, for whom might secrecy and evasion actually be a worse outcome?
Well, I think it just highlights the double bind of the politics of visibility, which has come up repeatedly today. The increased visibility of trans people and trans bodies has also resulted in a kind of new trans normativity. I think that in this, I was especially interested in the work of hacktivists like Anonymous, or, you know, some of the thinking of, whatever you may think of him, of Julian Assange, but also the work of Edward Glissant, you know, who kind of writes against the hegemony of the transparent, right? Like, the logic of transparency, of visibility, is a Western logic, right? That something has to be seen to be real, something has to be seen to be recognized. And Glissant has a kind of, he's articulating a politics of refusal, right? Like, I don't actually have to show you who I am. That's actually the way that I maintain a sense of my own autonomy, right? So I gave a talk a couple years ago called, part of the Black Data Project, called Against the Hegemony of the Transparent. Right, this idea that by seeing or by making oneself visible that one can achieve something. And I think, you know, the question is an interesting one: who can afford to be invisible? It's not that I would argue against all forms of visibility, or, you know, I think about the kinds of efforts that have been made in recent years, as someone talked about CC McDonald's case, to make the issues, say, facing trans women of color more visible, right, to a broader public. That's really important. But that doesn't mean that we have a right to trans women's interiority. And I think that those things are, especially in our culture, like, deeply intertwined, right? Part of it is the fantasy of self-sovereignty, like, that, you know, and then we have to express this sense of our interiority, and that, especially now, that expression is really a form of, you know, neoliberal self-branding. But it might be good to go dark. So, you know, just some ways that people do this, like in online, you use encryption, you make so that you can make it so that you can't be seen. You know, I've kind of, I don't use I don't have all of the best practices when it comes to my own internet use, but I have started to do certain things, like I just deleted my Facebook account. And I was just like, I've had enough. I'm just not gonna do it anymore. I'm not gonna give my labor to Facebook. I'm not gonna brand myself through Facebook. I'm not gonna participate. I just refuse. You know, I think sometimes we forget that refusal is a politics, right? But at the same time, like my refusal with Facebook and like my reluctance, I mean, today I tweeted up a storm, but if anyone who's been on my account sees, I've only like tweeted like 400 tweets in my 5 or 6 years on Twitter. But then I think of it, it becomes a different kind of gay market, because then I'm like boutique. You know, it's like only word of mouth. Like, I couldn't find him on Facebook. Where it's like, here's his number, you know. Like, so maybe there's a, you know, even here there's a kind of double edge. But I was really struck, you know, and Zach was the one who turned me, I really have to say that the Black Data Project owes a tremendous debt to Zach, because I've been thinking about this project for maybe about 6 months, and then I had like, you know, really long conversations with Zach, who is working on a book, I think it's called Informatic Opacity, or Informatic Opacities. And a lot of that is about, you know, again, a politics of refusal. So these masks were very, like, you know, exaggerated ways to refuse the logic of biometrics, right, which are becoming increasingly common, specifically facial recognition software. I think visibility and refusal will each kind of contain these like tensions or paradoxes within them. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah,
great. Okay, I wanted to move on to your porn fast paper, in which there was this dense image for me. I particularly, given that my students just did a comic strip on superpowers for me this week, I did love the fact that you could seize control of your sexuality and turn it into a superpower today. So I really wanted, as a sort of way into this article, I wanted to think about activity, what are they called? Activity trackers. Mm-hmm. And really about the erotics of activity tracking and of particularly kind of sexual, our obligations to be appropriately sexually active but not too sexually active. And so yours is about, a more kind of abstinence end of self-monitoring in your piece. But I also, of course, had to go online and look at what else there was. And so there is actually a whole brand called, I guess it's called Oh My Bod, which is all about how to monitor your masturbation activity and making sure you're masturbating enough, in the right ways, for long enough, as a sort of form of sexual health. And this becomes another kind of obligation. And I just thought this was a sort of a hilarious, you know, like rock and a hard place, or other kind of ambiguous metaphors. But I just really would love to hear you talk about, you know, the sort of, again, going back to this whole sort of the presentation of the neoliberal self as being sexual enough, not too sexual, and the role of apps and technologies and the Fitbit. Mm-hmm. I actually tried to find out whether there was a Fitbit that traced sexual activity, but they haven't quite got there yet. Yeah. But anyway, yes.
Yeah. So I mean, this is really part of the part of the sort of larger biopolitics of self-management, self-regulation, and. I'll talk about the porn fast stuff first because, you know, I had, before I even encountered these whole things, I had gone on porn fast starting in like 2009. And a lot of it was just like I'd found porn so boring and repetitive. I was just like, I need to take a break. Or I would find myself using it like when I was really tired and it would be like, oh, I was just going to like jerk off before bed, but it became like a 2-hour edging session and then I only got like 4 hours of sleep or something. So there was this sort of effort of like, how can I manage something that is like excessive or whatever. And then, I can't remember how I came to the idea of writing about it, but yeah, I think that it really highlights again both all of the ambivalence we have about sex and sexual practices, and also this sort of new demand towards self-optimization, like be the best person you can be, right? Which means monitoring all of your behavior. And there was a great keynote. Lisa, do you remember there was Natasha Dow Scholl, but then there was someone else who talked about the history at the Affect Theory Conference, the history of essentially managing, using technology to learn how to manage workers. Melissa Gregg, that's right, sorry, the name was on the tip of my tongue. Just, if you guys aren't familiar with that work, it's very, very interesting. Also, Natasha Dowell-Scholl on addiction and machine gambling in Las Vegas. These are two excellent pieces of work. And Melissa Gregg really talks about this history, like where the history of these sort of self-monitoring devices comes from. And you know, she traces it back to the ways that media technologies like film were used to record and then optimize and therefore manage the behavior of laborers. So we are all laborers on our own projects of self-optimization, you know, whether that is porn fasting, managing our affective or different kinds of affective excesses, you know, maximizing our opportunities for whatever, for sociality, for meaningful work, and so on. So, you know, I really look at this as part of this larger demand that we all, you know, self-regulate. And again, if you guys, you know, one of the things about the Fordist process, the Fordist assembly line, you know, and Fordism in, more broadly, was that gender and sex and sexuality were not peripheral to that process. It was they were actually central, right? That, you know, you couldn't be a worker if you didn't have a wife and a good, an appropriate and decorous sort of sex life. And, you know, so this was part of the logic of, you know, capitalism as it developed in the West, that you have to manage your appetites, whether these are, you know, appetites for sex or tobacco, or, you know, insert your excess here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I was thinking, you know, when you move on to talking about porn fasts, not as a noun, but as an adjective, and so the idea of, you know, fast porn, and the idea of kind of slow porn or slow fapping as a form, is that a form of liberation? You know, if we're going with the slow movement, slow food, you know, slow professors, if we become slow masturbators, is that, you know, is that a form of resistance, or is that another form of self-monitoring?
I think both.
Right.
Someone was talking about, I wanted to ask in the panel earlier, the queer, Adrian, the queer game archive, the LGBTQ game archive, because, you know, there is this, you know, there's been this, I don't know how big the trend is, maybe, I think it's just like a minor trend toward gamifying masturbation. So, you know, there are pornographic videos on Pornhub, say, called, the rubric is cock hero, like guitar hero, cock hero. So the idea is that you masturbate to the beat of music that is being, that is overlaid on pornographic material, so that, you know, you have like a stroke count, and you're supposed to, you know, you're supposed to, like, you know, you win by orgasming at the right time. So other people are doing this work. I haven't really, but it is a form.
That's great.
But it does lots of things. Like, maybe it's about slow porn and like extending the pleasure of like an autoerotic encounter. It's also self-management regulation, because you're being told what to do. So maybe there's also some sort of masochistic pleasure in, you know, delaying, deferring, and being, you know, as an occasional sub, like being told what to do. Like, there's a pleasure that rests in that itself. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay.
I was interesting. Sorry, just to go back to Adrian, I was like interested. Like, are you gonna look at that? Like, is that part of the? Is that part of a game? Cock hero. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So on to our last image, which was just irresistible to me. This is from the same article about masturbation practices and monitoring one's masturbation. And I just thought context was everything here. And I love that this says, please masturbate in your bedroom. Okay, I'll go and do that right now. So what I want to, and I'm sort of using this is a little bit cheap, but I'm using this as a way into a conversation about the likely failure of method. I'm sure that this didn't work. And I just don't
believe... Well, it's not real. It was a meme.
Oh, now I know.
So it was like a hoax. So okay. People...
You don't talk about it anymore.
I thought it was in the... Anyway, we'll see.
Okay.
Maybe I just...
But no,
that.
But I could totally... I believe this because I could totally see this as something that would go
so...
out. And I love the idea that our drains are not built to withstand steam. Anyway, so why don't
you
talk
imagine,
about
like,
it?
Really viscous. Right. Really viscous.
Tell us about the meme, and then we can talk about
method. So it was just like, I can't remember what it, like how it came about, but it wasn't only at UPenn, but this just happened to be the one that I used in the paper and in the talk that accompanied it. But again, in the PornFest paper, I was sort of linking it to histories of self-regulation, especially around masturbation and sex, right? That the, some of the earliest medical tracts, like, you know, if we think about Foucauldian birth of the clinic, blah, 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 were specifically tracts about against masturbation, right? So, like, these pseudoscientific, kind of hysterical tracts that gained actually widespread circulation. And it was really to sort of point out the degree to which these are long-standing within a sort of Western Judeo-Christian tradition. There are these long-standing... demands to self-regulate. And I think what's interesting in this moment, but also when these were posted, people didn't know immediately that they were...
Were they actually physically made and posted?
Yeah, and put around.
Okay, right.
So it both sort of hailed all the masturbators to, you know, to reflect on their own practices. Mm-hmm. Well, I'll just leave it. Yeah, it hailed them to like really... to really reflect on their own practices, but it also signaled this much longer standing history about what's an appropriate expression of sexuality. And you see this as well, as I write about in the paper, in the development of whole fields, right, around sexual compulsivity and addiction, right, where these, none of them have really been accepted as diagnostic criteria. And you have different approaches to managing this. So, for some, for example, having an orgasm a day would constitute hypersexuality disorder. Like, it would be considered disordered. I mean, for lots of people, it'd be like, I would love to have an orgasm every day, maybe more than
one. Well, only one?
More than what? Why only one, right? So, I mean, in many key ways, it just shows the ongoing ways that sex, masturbation, like the excesses are, there are efforts to sort of rein them in, there are efforts to sort of demand that we regulate ourselves around them, and so on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great. So just as a final question, what are you working on now?
So right now I'm trying to work on two book projects, which I don't recommend anyone ever do. The first one is called The Political Aesthetics of Drag, and it was based on fieldwork in Berlin, Israel, Palestine, and New York City with artists and activists who use drag as a form of political aesthetic expression. So I was working with I've been working with a range of people, cis, trans, bio queens, trans men who used to perform as drag kings when they were a lesbian, and then who win best drag queen awards after they transition. There are certain themes that have been emerging, but I'm trying to be a good researcher, I'm not actually coming to any conclusions yet. So there's all kinds of stuff about racial antipathy, political violence, gentrification, and sort of the utility of drag, and I'm really interested in Teal's work here around transmediality, the potential for drag to engage questions of politics. And, you know, in Butler's famous essay on Paris is Burning, she's really clear, like, you know, drag both appropriates and subverts, it reinforces and denaturalizes gender norms, gender expectations, right? So I'm not saying that drag is inherently subversive, I'm not saying that drag is, you know, has the potential to denaturalize gender. I'm really looking at specific case studies of artists and activists who are using it in often very complicated ways, including using, say, a politics of refusal. Or to be like so unappealing that there doesn't seem to be a point of entry, so a kind of anti-politics in some cases. So I'm working on that project, and the fieldwork in Berlin was finished. The fieldwork in Israel is like 2/3 of the way done. And even though I've been living back in New York for almost a year and a half, I have not finished that fieldwork. It's just maybe it's so daunting. I know the people that I want to work with. I've sort of identified them, but I'm going to be 42 in April. I go to bed at 9:30 most nights. So getting, and I live in Westchester. So getting to the city has just proved so difficult in to see drag shows that will start at 1 or 2 in the morning. I could do it in Berlin when I was on sabbatical because, you know, I would, you know, take a disco nap, wake up at 8, have like a really strong coffee and stay out till 3, which was actually usually when the parties were just getting started. Like when people were coming in to check all of their clothes at the door, I was like, this, maybe I want to stay here. So then I'm working on Black Data. And I have a kind of, you know, orientation toward that project. The piece in No Tea, No Shade is kind of a manifesto. There'll be at least one chapter on liberating ourselves locally, a couple chapters on artists and activists, including Zach, and a chapter on gaming. That's that.
Great. So I'm sure many of you have things that you would like to ask, so please. Could we use a microphone just to
thank you? Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. It's a real pleasure. I feel like we're just getting started.
Yeah.
Thank you. This was really such a fun dialogue to watch as well, or be part of. Earlier in your talk, Shaka, in the beginning, you were talking about learning from speculative fiction and speculative ethnography, and obviously this conversation around Afrofuturism. And I'm wondering if you could give us more of what that actually looks like in practice. So using sci-fi, speculative fiction, performance art or performance studies mm-hmm. in your work, especially, you know, as a disciplinary anthropologist, what that means for you.
So even when I was in grad school, I was thinking about something I was calling then queer science fictions or queer social science fictions. So thinking, I was a sci-fi nerd, I still kind of am. So using the kinds of things that people like Judith, the feminist STS people, Octavia Butler, that kind of work, Sam Delaney, all of that work was super influential for me in thinking about gender, sexuality, and race. And that orientation informs like a project like Black Data, which, you know, I'm not an adept technologist in the sense that I don't have coding skills, but I've been following this for a long time. I think in terms of anthropology, you know, we touched on this briefly just a few moments ago. Like I'm involved in anthropology as a discipline. I understand myself as an anthropologist, but I'm not always recognized as such by other anthropologists. And it has to do less with my training or than with my archives and my objects and my ambivalence actually is not the right word. It's sort of almost indifference to some of the conventional conceits of anthropology. Like, you know, and not that boundaries or liminality or ritual or magic or witchcraft aren't interesting. I just don't feel this demand to adhere to those tropes. So I draw from like a really wide variety of literatures, and I'm almost always reading science fiction and fantasy to this day. Yeah, and there's actually a flourishing of this work. You know, for so many years there was really just, you know, Octavia Butler and a couple of other, Sam Delaney and a couple other folks, but there's been a real flourishing of black authored science fiction and fantasy in recent years, including who wrote A History of Seven Killings? Where is he at? Can't remember his name. It's on the tip of my tongue. But he's writing a 3-part Tolkien-esque Afro lineaged.
I'm thinking
trilogy.
Of like Ruha Benjamin's work, right?
Yeah,
she uses a lot of speculative fiction and sci-fi in her analytical papers. And
yeah.
I'm teaching queer robotics right now, a class that I'm just making up on like using cyborgs and sci-fi, and having my students mix sci-fi narrative writing with their analytical papers, but it's proving harder to actually execute, you know, and then on top of that, I'm just a postdoc and I write this way and it's not accepted in a certain disciplinary fashion, right? So like, I guess it's so nice to talk about, but at the same time, when we actually put it in practice, people don't necessarily want to see all of these mixed methods or mixed ways of writing.
I mean, my advice to anyone here who's, you know, finishing or hasn't finished or whatever, I think just do what you want to do. It sounds cheesy, but do what you really want to do. I mean, if you want to try to aim for those top tier anthropology journals, fine, but you're going to have to like write in that. I mean, for years, the stacks of American anthropologists just stacked up next to my toilet, and I never did more than like skim the table of contents. And like every like once in a while, they'd be like, oh, that looks interesting. But I would just say keep doing it the way you're doing it. You know, it took me 11 years before I was actually interviewed for a job in anthropology. You know, but then they were like, you're a really interesting anthropologist. So I would just say, like, actually be eclectic, you know, draw from different disciplines. And yeah. Yeah.
First of all, thank you, both of you, so much. That was wonderful. I'm like fervently tweeting and photographing away. So Shaka, you mentioned transparency and being a little bit critical of transparency and sort of the safe space of interiority. And I'm wondering if you could speak a bit more about the tension between wanting to preserve interiority, being sort of mindfully critical of transparency, on contact with the idea that visibility and being out is historically so important for marginalized communities, and what that's been like for you as a scholar, I guess, to talk about and look into.
So one of the ways that that cypherpunks and hacktivists will talk about the issue of transparency is transparency for the government, opacity for the rest of us. So there are certain forms of transparency that I'm not opposed to. I think that governmental practices, for example, like everything the government does should be transparent, the things that academic institutions should do, the peer review process should be more transparent. Like, it's not that I'm opposed to transparency, it's this idea that I would challenge the idea actually that visibility and coming out was good for everyone, right? There were consequences for that, even for the sort of more mainstream gay and lesbian movement, right? Like one consequence of that increased visibility was the kind of marginalization and exclusion of trans people and people of color and trans people of color. And it took, you know, these fights that had to sort of take place on the terrain under the logic of visibility that I think were really, you know, problematic and came at certain kinds of costs, right? Like, why are we talking, like, why does it take this long for someone like Laverne Cox to gain visibility and like achieve a kind of coherence to a broader public? The question of interiority is a complicated one, and I'll try to answer it in a couple ways. And then maybe if I haven't tied them together, you can ask a follow-up question. So one is a sort of like understanding interiority as a kind of fantasy. A fantasy of self-sovereignty, a fantasy that whatever's going inside our head is us and we're in control. So lots of people have done this kind of critique, and this is not a critique of political agency or saying that this thing is absent, it's that whatever we think of ourselves as selves is less coherent than we imagine for all kinds of reasons. This has sort of been, so just as I've started using more like they, them pronouns, I've also been talking more and more about spirituality in my public academic forums. Yeah. So as someone who was really weaned in feminist post-structuralist theory, an anti-essentialist framework, right, which would deconstruct the self, you know, people like Lauren Berlant are kind of that same history and that same tradition. So I don't believe in the sovereign self, but I do kind of believe in essences, like, or the soul, or something, you know, like that. So there's this weird kind of, you know, I'm finding this weird tension where I want to be critical of narratives of interiority, acknowledging that people feel like they have interiors, and at the same time, like, in my spiritual practice, kind of doing both, right? Like, in Buddhist or tantric or all kinds of, actually, all these sorts of mystical traditions, the things that you think of as yourself kind of drop away. And it's not like you don't have a personality or that you're not engaged with the world, but the easiest point of entry for this would be like your reactivity. Like everyone has like the things that are like they get really reactive to. And so, you know, if you're doing lots of spiritual practice, you start to just chill the fuck out. Yeah. And you are still yourself, whatever that means, this like loose assemblage of like patterns and behaviors and thoughts and whatever. But you just don't have that same reactivity. You like something has sort of dropped away. So there is this kind of sense in which the emptiness of that is sort of emphasized in certain strands of, say, Buddhist meditation can actually dovetail with this deconstructed postmodern self. There was a really interesting, actually, she became my teacher for some years. She was an academic out of Stanford who'd been doing tantric practice for decades and then who just left the academy and just became like a full-time, you know, spiritual teacher. But before she did, she wrote a really great book that's not very well known called Avatar Bodies. It's the subtitle, I think, is A Tantra for Posthumanism. And she does all kinds of interesting things in that book.
I guess if I can ask sort of a follow-up question, yeah. That sort of a remark. That's wonderful to hear. I mean, I research in philosophy and STS, and also consider myself to be a very spiritual person. I deal with the struggle between interiority, visibility, you know, also weaned in post-structuralist theory while trying to reconcile that with, let's say, more metaphysical solid structures and essences. So with that all being said, I wonder if you could just reflect on the difficulty of being a public scholar or just anybody who's using social media trying to put this in a way that sort of makes sense to the digital age, because I'm sure you have some experience of that too.
I mean, spiritual this, or?
I guess just the complexity of what it is that you're doing and how you're trying to present yourself, because this is obviously really complicated stuff and just making sense of it, what your reactions have been and all that.
So there are a couple of things I've started doing. So my writing was always kind of loose and conversational, and mm-hmm. I think that's kind of intensified as more time, maybe after tenure, but even before I was in that thing. So writing more associatively mm-hmm. and just sort of seeing what comes up. So at the Affect Theory Conference where I gave a talk, I kind of had these different sort of chunks, and the last one was just, it was like a meditation exercise. So it becomes more about an effort to evoke feelings and sensations than it is to like prove a point.
Yeah.
So that's part of it. Mm-hmm. Because I think, I mean, fundamentally, I mean, someone like Lauren Berlant has like been deeply influential for me, in part because she is a theorist of ambivalence, mm-hmm. right? And so even the PornFast paper, you know, when people have read it, they're like, I can't tell if you're like for PornFast or against it, or like you criticize it, but then you did it. And I'm like, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a very non-dualistic answer.
Yeah, it's a non-dual. It's a non-dual thing. So yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Thank you.
Hi. Thanks so much for that conversation. I have a question that's also a bit about sort of invisibility and thinking. Again, about this.
Speak up a little bit.
Oh yeah, sorry. I have a question also about sort of visibility and thinking about privilege and who has privilege to be visible or invisible. And I was thinking also a bit about sort of what you said about going off Facebook, and also thinking about the way that we're all sort of compelled to self-brand, and especially folks who are junior scholars from the market, like maybe can't go off Facebook, right? Or I wouldn't actually have heard about this event if I hadn't checked Facebook and seen my friend post that she was coming to this thing, right? So there's also these ways in which it's hard to opt out. And so I guess one question is, are there other strategies of resistance besides that kind of opting out or going dark? And I guess I'm thinking too in this moment of fake news and, you know, the sort of destruction of authenticity, what would it look like to maybe proliferate fake information about oneself? I mean, is that a way to kind of get out of the marketing scheme, right? If you're, I was reading a sort of how to create a resistance Twitter account, right? And one of the things is, you know, you should actually be involved in various things so it doesn't look so suspicious. So you sort of create a fake profile about yourself and do all of this stuff, right? So I guess I'm just curious what either of you had to say about maybe how we deal with the imperative to always be producing data about ourselves. Who can opt out? Can we opt out? And if we can't opt out, what else can we do?
Actually, be interested in hearing what you think about that.
Well, I'm not sure if this is still the case, but I do remember a few years ago, a book by Joe Turow, who's in the Annenberg School here, came out. I think it was in one of his books, and he did some research about people who use store loyalty cards, you know, like your, you know, whatever, CVS card or whatever. And he talked to lots of people about, said this is how your data gets used and, you know, blah, blah, blah. And they didn't care, you know. And I think most of the time, most of us don't really care. I think some of us care a lot, and I think some of us can't afford not to care. And, you know, when the whole Snowden thing came out, I mean, I was like, oh my God, you know, and it was just like, huh. But the really pernicious end of that argument is, well, if you're not doing anything wrong, why do you care? You know, and that's really icky for two reasons. One is, you know, the presumption that people who are doing something wrong, according to whom, you know, deserve to be, you know, named and shamed for that. And the other is that there are all sorts of ways our data are getting used, which are not about security or presumed security, however you want to call that. I mean, security in massive, you know, quotation marks. And in terms of marketization and things like that. And so, a lot of people would even go so far as to say, well, if I get better ads, more appropriate ads, because they know what I'm looking at, then great. I don't want to look at one for a Subaru because I just bought a BMW, you know. I think in terms of what many of us, I mean, I'm saying us, but I don't know where I am on this. I mean, I'm on Facebook, you know, ish, and, you know, and I don't know whether I just sort of feel like I've lost the fight, so I might as well just succumb. But yeah, I am very worried about that. Well, you know, the only people who should really worry about this are people who have reason to worry because they're doing something wrong, as though that's a clear sense, yeah.
So just really, you know, quickly, I think you're in a difficult situation. I do think that you probably do need to stay on Facebook for a little while, or, you know, choose your social media platform and, you know, collect the, like, once I had Lauren Borland's home phone number, like, I'm like, fuck that. And I'm like, I have all the connections I need now. I mean, I'm joking, but at a certain point, I was just like tired of giving them an hour a day of my time and like 30 browser tabs. So I think you're in a difficult situation, you know, given the thorough neoliberalization of the academy. So there are a couple of concrete things that I would suggest, assuming you're going to not burn it all down and go live in the woods, which is get some professional consulting about it. Even recently I used someone like Karen Kelsky. A lot of people hate her guts. I actually, maybe the masochism thing again, I like someone who's really mean to me and says that sounds pretentious and horrible, and I'll be like, oh, okay, Karen, thanks. And then when she gives you praise, then you're like, oh my God. So I would use something like that. I was just saying to Mitali, you know, not to worry so much about landing the right publication, just get publications. Now, this is different in the UK. I would say in the UK that if you really want to be an academic, then you have to adhere to these ridiculous, you know, expectations to publish in high impact journals and so on. But, you know, I think in the US, you know, you can still, you know, manage with just peer reviewed work, though it's becoming crazier and crazier. You know, like people are coming out of grad school now with four or five publications. When I came out, I had one and I got a job. People before me didn't have to have one. You know, it's the demand to produce is sort of more and more. But I think that the tendency for junior scholars is to sort of abject yourselves to this process, and I would just challenge you not to do that if you can. And that can take many different forms outside of outright refusal to participate.
I don't see a hand. I have a question about lesbian queer temporality versus spatiality to bring up. So how many of you here maybe have ever said, there are no butches on OkCupid, right? Have you said this? Mm-hmm. And maybe you've said there are no femmes on OkCupid. I think this is why there's an attractiveness algorithm, right? And I don't know if anybody's written about this, but I think about it a lot. And in New York, you know, I saw no femmes, my friends saw no butches. I sat next to her, typed in all the names of the femmes I thought were cute, and it changed my algorithm for 72 hours, and then it changed it back, right? Because there's an attractiveness algorithm. So if you're a bisexual woman, oh my God, you're the pinnacle of it all. And as if you're a lesbian woman, then there are these like creepy cis dudes that mark themselves as women briefly and as lesbians, and then like on Tinder, right? You see them, you're like, come on. And they're ultra clicking on feminine, lesbian, queer, bisexual women. And as a result, the mannish woman is like the least attractive, the least clicked on, and then they can't find each other. What's funny about OkCupid is when I talk to lesbians and queers about it, it's safe. Because there's an algorithm that tells us we're supposed to be together. I'm like, no, you've got to be like, you're kidding me, right? Like, you know, that's all caca. And most of the questions, if you actually go in, are like, should gay people be able to get married? Yeah, should gay people be nice to gay people? Like, duh. You know, like, and so, like, you forgot that the basis of the questions was just like about how great we are. And so I think more for, it's not like the temporality. I think U-hauling, of course, is heavily related to the political economy of 78 cents on the dollar, or 53 cents on the dollar for Latino women, breaking that down by race. And I think also, you know, you break up and you're in these longer relationships. I don't know if it's a socialization or a swan song kind of thing, but I do think there's something to this that it's not as much slow, but that's kind of like being in a safe space that women, people socialize as women or who identify as women are not safe, like the gays, the male gays. And I think that is part of the monetization of it, that they don't feel comfortable. The monetization of it. So they're, like, there's a lack of them in any place, and then you don't see them. You're like, well, no one's on, right? So you back off, and there's not that mass of them, and it's not and lesbian queer bodies and spaces mostly being more private or semi-private. I think that has something to do with. I was just wondering what you think about.
Yeah, I don't think they're as geographically dense, those networks. I mean, you could. I mean, maybe like Provincetown, or like, you know, I'm not sure people are.
But even Northampton, I've got data. Yeah. It's not happening.
Yeah. It's not happening. Yeah.
I live there. Yeah.
I mean, what I would say is these they aren't effective anyway, so don't use them. I mean, what do you think are the kind of key sites for lesbian sociality or like brought?
Autostraddle. Huh? I do think autostraddle is one for sure. And I think like these kind of like fleeting Facebook groups that come and go, Twitter hashtags. You know, it's like we're still talking like Castells 1983. Well, the men have territorial aspirations, and the women seem to like potlucks, and I couldn't find them. Like literally, that's what he says. And so I don't know. I think you know, when there's less bars, there's less public spaces, there's less money, there's less drinking. You can't process as much alcohol, literally. It creates a different form of space, and there's all these expectations of these publics or even counterpublics that you can't live up to, and there's a sense of other kind of failure, like a failure on top of queer failure that's specific. So yeah, I think that's what I was thinking about.
It's amazing that we ever get together.
Yeah. It is, and that's why then we U-Haul, we're like, oh, thank God, I found you. Yeah.
Well, that's why you need to keep having more conferences like this. Like that's.
Yeah, you can be loud, can't you?
I don't know exactly what gender orientation to identify with that, but I think that politically mobilized spaces are also cruising spaces for also gender studies conferences. Also, you know, like queers are just stood up like hello.
Yeah, the speed dating is starting now. Or it's slow dating.
But I think that there's like a problem asking, and I hate to do that, to use that word because it's so unsexy.
Sorry, what was the word?
Multitasking. But I think that's like a very, like I think that still remains true, even if Take Back Tonight and IWD and so so many of those other things are not happening. I think that politically energized spaces are also erotic spaces for a lot of us. Yeah.
Cool. So we are gonna wrap up now and not talk about my dating life. So thank you guys so much.
Thanks, guys.